Good evening.
Good evening.
He is risen.
He is risen.
It is great to say that, and what such joy it is. That was one of the ways that Christians would greet each other, and that way they would know if you were a Christian by saying, "He is risen," and the other would say, "He is risen indeed." And so we still say that today. Despite all of life's challenges right now, we celebrate the fact that Christ is risen, and that means forgiveness and everlasting life for us. A couple of things as we're going along. If you don't have one already, make sure that you have one of these bulletins. And tonight we'll do kind of a hybrid service. And what that means is that we'll be working right out of our bulletin, but also we'll use our hymnals. All right. And the hymnals, of course, if you're new this evening, are right there in the holders in front of you. So you'll use this, and then at a certain point, we will move to Divine Service Setting 4. So just be prepared for that so that nothing gets in the way of receiving God's wonderful gifts. Also, we are in need of volunteers to ring the bells at Kroger for the Salvation Army, and there's a sheet back there, a yellow tablet like this, where you can schedule yourself for a time. So please take advantage of that great thing. Some information about Bible studies. This weekend, I will start a three-part Bible study that really echoes our stewardship campaign that we had a number of weeks ago. So talking about stewardship to the nation, the community, and then the family. You can tell that it's right there. It's locked in my mind. I'm ready to go. But that will start this weekend and then go for 3 weeks. Also, Run Hard, Rest Well will continue in here, and Paul Wendt will be leading a Bible class on the stained glass windows, and that will be in the cafeteria. So please take advantage of those things. And as we begin our worship, we certainly want to wish wonderful blessings on you and your family as we have some strange get-togethers for and maybe more intimate get-togethers for Thanksgiving at this time. So we'll begin with, go ahead. We continue at this time in our bulletins on page 1. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him, songs of praise. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, his faithfulness to all generations. Be seated for our next hymn. We continue at this time on page 2 in our bulletins, Confession and Absolution. Please rise. I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Let us then confess our sins to God, our gracious Father. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, creator of all things, we confess that we are indeed sinful. We have broken our fellowship with you and have turned away from one another in our thinking, speaking, and doing. You have done the we have and have not done the good you demand. We have not lived lives that are continuing expressions of gratitude. We do repent and are truly sorry for all of our sins. Have mercy on us because of Jesus, our Lord, and the source of our salvation. Grant that by the working of the Holy Spirit, we live faithfully and work until that time when we rejoice. God has promised forgiveness to those who repent of their sins and turn to him for grace. Therefore, as a called and ordained servant of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord steadfast keep you in the Holy Spirit, lead you to greater faith and obedience, grant you a spirit of ongoing faithfulness, and finally bring you to live with him forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're seated for our next hymn. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, we adore you as the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and with the whole church on earth and all the hosts of heaven, we ascribe to your honor and blessing, thanksgiving, and praise. Grant that we with thankful hearts receive your great mercies and express your gratitude, not only with our lips but also in our lives as we give ourselves to your service and walk before you in holiness and righteousness all of our days. Give us faith that works in love, hope, and never disappoints, kindness that never fails, confidence in you that never wavers, patience that does not grow weary, and courage always ready to confess Christ, that we live in your mercy and die in your peace, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Confessing faith and expressing thanks are completely linked together. In the Small Catechism, Martin Luther underscored the theme of thankfulness in his explanation of the first article of the Creed, which focuses on God the Creator. Together we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has made me and all creatures, that he has given me my body and my soul, eyes, ears, and all my members, my reason and all my senses, and still takes care of them. For all this, it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him. He also gives me clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, wife and children, land, animals, and all I have. He richly and daily provides me with all that I need to support this body and life. For all this, it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him. He defends me against all danger and guards and protects me from all evil. All this he does out of fatherly divine goodness and mercy without any merit or worthiness in me. For all this, it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true. We continue with our next hymn. Let us pray. Almighty God, your mercies are new every morning, and you graciously provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Continue with our next hymn. The Old Testament reading for this evening is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 8. The whole commandment that I command you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply, and go in and possess the land the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out, and your foot did not swell these 40 years. Know then that in your heart, as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. So you shall keep the commandments of the Lord by your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs, flowing out of the hills and valleys, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land which whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills you can dig copper, and you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle lesson is taken from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, chapter 4. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will fill your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you Philippians yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except you only. Even in Thessalonica, you sent help to me for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. To our God, the Father, be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We turn in our hymnals to page 205. Hymnals page 205 for the Alleluia and verse. Please rise. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. On the way to Jerusalem, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee, and as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? What are the 9? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of the Lord. We continue on page 207 in our hymnals, page 207, the Apostles' Creed. We confess together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we continue with our next hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. What was the big thing going on in our country in 1863? The Civil War. It was certainly the one thing that had enveloped everybody's minds, the collective consciousness, in 1863. Well, very likely the biggest battle of the Civil War was Gettysburg, and an unbelievable amount of soldiers died in that event. It would be one thing to say that 150,000 soldiers, North and South, died in the entire Civil War, but that's not true. 150,000 Confederate and Union together, 150,000 people died, soldiers, at the Battle of Gettysburg. Now, compare that to this. In Vietnam, during the entire 10 years, 10 years that the United States was involved, 58,000 by comparison. In the Korean War, from 1950 to 1953, it was 33,000. And that's over a series of years. Now, the idea here is not to push some notion that those who died in Vietnam or Korea are less significant or paid less of a sacrifice. The idea is to wrap this issue of Abraham Lincoln establishing Thanksgiving Day in our nation on the event of the death of 150,000 people. On that day, at the Battle of Gettysburg, following that when it took place, after the death of so many, what does Abraham Lincoln do? He establishes the national holiday of Thanksgiving. How could he possibly do that with such a tremendous price paid for the edification of our country and an end to slavery? But that's what he does. That's what he does, recognizing the wonderful gifts that God gives on that occasion. Well, here comes God, and he speaks to the people on the occasion of their going into the promised land. And he wraps the whole thing. He says, you know what? I want you to be real careful to do all the things that I've told you to do up until now. As you are going into the promised land, don't forget what I taught you. Remember what your fathers and your grandfathers did. They disobeyed, and they had to walk around in the wilderness until they were all past. And you were born over the course of 40 years now that you are going in to the promised land. God says something very strange in this passage. He says, I humbled you and I tested you in the wilderness without food, without water. I tested you. Why? So that it would be known what is the content of your hearts. To know what is the content of your hearts. Now, before we explore that, consider this anecdote. Believe it or not, when I was in grade school, there were a couple of times when I cheated on my work. When I cheated on my work, either a test or my homework. One incident in particular, I was in fifth grade. Mr. Sprague was my teacher down at Bethlehem in Fort Wayne, and I didn't have my spelling homework done. So what did I do? I borrowed my best friend's book, and during class, I copied his work and got it all done so it was ready. That was my plan. The reality was is that the teacher caught me doing it. And did he say, please don't try to do that again? No, he didn't. He pulled me out of my chair right there, right in front of the entire class. He took out this 40-pound huge tree of wood with nails pounded through it. No, not at all. That was just what it felt like. But it was a piece of wood, and it had holes drilled in it. True story. And he whacked me right there. Now, it had two whacks, really. Was one, the pain, of course, and also the humiliation of having this done in front of my peers. Well, what is that all about? Mr. Sprague wanted to test. He wanted to see if I had done my homework. You see, what's interesting here about this is that God doesn't mean that he's testing us to see what we know so that he learns. He's telling us that he's testing us so that we know what is in our hearts. Here's the connection to that anecdote about the spelling. Probably by the time we got to the test, Mr. Sprague knew how I was going to do on the test. He knew how I was going to do on the test because he had seen all of my bad work leading up to that. So as he gives me the spelling test, he's not surprised that I don't do well. Why? Because I haven't had my homework in, because all the pretests leading up to that were bad. So he wasn't surprised when he gave me the test and I didn't do well. That relates to this issue of God saying, I tested you to know what was in your hearts. So God doesn't test us in this world. He doesn't make us go through scarcity and hardship so that he finds out how we're going to do. He already knows. Instead, he allows us to go through tribulation. He allows us to go without in order that I would know the content of my heart. Now, what's the worth of that? What's the purpose of that? It's connected to something that we do at the beginning of the service. One of the first things we do at the beginning of the service, we sing an opening hymn, Confession and Absolution. Now, why do we do that? Is God aware of my sins already? He sure is. But I come to the Lord, and part of confessing my sins is so that I'm aware of my need for salvation. Because my sinful nature says, you're not a sinner. My sinful nature says, you don't need forgiveness. My sinful nature says, God, how dare you tell me that I need forgiveness of all of my sins? So coming into the Lord's presence and saying, yeah, I look at my life and I found out I'm a sinner. I need forgiveness. That's good for me. Because if I don't, I run the risk of walking away from Jesus and his salvation. So tying this all together, the idea here is that God shows us and he shows me the content of my heart so that I know that I need his forgiveness. And that's a good thing. Remember how God dished out the manna to the people of Israel in the wilderness? He didn't give them 40 tons of it and allow them to store it up and garner it in barns. But how much did he give? A little bit. Every day. We say that in the Lord's Prayer. And give us our daily bread. Now, why would God do that? Why would he make us trust in him? Exactly for that reason. He doesn't give us enough to store it up. Because if I store it up, then I'm trusting in my storehouse and not in him. In other words, he allows us to have just what we need sometimes for the purpose of staying close to him. So I don't learn to rely on how much I have saved in the bank. I don't learn to rely on all these other things that I have and my good health and my friends. But instead, I learn to trust in him and him alone. And that's a good thing. That's a blessing. Well, why is it then that the Lord calls us to give thanks? Why do we do this issue, this giving of thanks during this holiday? It's because it's a good thing for us to do. It's a good thing for us to do. And this is why. It's part of our health and our health as being Christians. God doesn't need our thanks in terms of feeling good about himself. God doesn't need us to come to church and to say, thank you, God, so that he feels good and feels affirmed for all that he has done for us. Again, it's good for us in this way. When I go in church or at home or wherever I am and I say, God, thank you for this food, when we pray that at the beginning of our meal, it reinforces in my mind that what? It reinforces in my mind that I have this because God gave it to me. And again, like we spoke about in the sinful nature, my sinful nature wants to forget about God. I earned this. I did this. This is my food. This is my money that I paid here. It's mine. But when I say thank you to God, it reinforces in my mind that he's given this to me. That is why we come to the Lord's house and we do this, to be reminded of that. Because when I am reminded of that, I have peace. When I forget about it, I have fear and chaos. But when I am reminded that God gives to me, that's the source of my peace. C.S. Lewis said, true humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. Ted Turner said, if only I had a little humility, then I'd be perfect. In this passage, God talks a lot about being humble, about humbling people. And he says this to us. He says, I allowed you to be humbled. In other words, I let you go through tough times. Can we appreciate that right now? Even in the midst of COVID and all of its uncertainties, all of its inconveniences, and all of its even loss of income, all of its strife at home, and even the death of loved ones who have passed because of COVID, we can relate to being humbled. As we continue to hear about strife in our country, even though it is no longer in the forefront of the news, all of the things that we're dealing with, we can certainly understand the idea of being humbled. But we look at Jesus Christ and we say, here is someone who humbled himself. One of the things that we are looking forward to as we begin Advent, and we have this lovely Advent wreath here, is going to the center candle, and that, of course, is Christmas. We light that on Christmas Eve to celebrate the birth of Christ. The issue of humility is a very big part of Christmas. The idea that God Almighty took on human flesh, that God humbled himself to take on human flesh. It's a big deal. It's saying that the creator of the universe, the eternal God who holds all of the universe together, who is without time and without space, deigned to take on a body like mine, except he was perfect. Jesus Christ allowed himself to be humbled. And not merely to be humbled, but to go through life amidst temptation and betrayal, and finally to be arrested, to be betrayed, to be spit upon and be punched and nailed to a cross, and finally to be murdered. That in the midst of our humility, we reflect on the loving humility of Jesus Christ, who did this without need, without sin, without any iniquity for which he had to pay, but instead he paid for ours. And it brings to mind for us an important distinction. There's a difference between two things, two issues that are very close, and that is discipline and punishment. Discipline and punishment. They're words that we use interchangeably, like joy and happy, but there's an important difference. When I was whacked by my cruel and heartless medieval torturing spelling teacher back when I was a child, that was discipline. His goal was to get me to do my homework. That wasn't punishment. Punishment is different. Discipline has the goal of growth, of correction, of being better than you are right now. But when Jesus Christ died on the cross, when he suffered for my sins, for my lack of willingness to give praise, for my selfish heart and my unwillingness to give to those in need, and my unwillingness to trust in Jesus Christ, Jesus wasn't disciplined. He didn't need to be disciplined. He was punished. He was punished for me and for you. All of my wrongs, all of your sins were placed on the head of Jesus Christ, simplified by a crown of thorns pressed into his head. He was punished for me. This passage, finally, that we look at from Deuteronomy takes us back to Exodus. Do you remember what God said to the people at the Passover? He said many things to them, but he talked about clothing, of all things. He said, as you celebrate the Passover tonight, what I want you to do is make sure that you have your pack ready to go, that you got your staff in your hand, and that you got your sandals on your feet. Why? Because you're leaving soon, and you're going to be ready to go. You're leaving soon and you're going to be ready to go. That has an important impact for us, especially as in the passage that I'm preaching on right now, God says that I didn't allow your clothing to be tattered out or your feet to swell or your sandals to fall apart. You see, because Jesus Christ humbled himself and died on the cross, we are ready. We are ready just like the people at the Passover, ready to go. And our comfort is this: whatever happens, whether this person is elected president or not, whether the turmoil in our country comes to our front door, whether I am sick with COVID or not, whether I die from COVID or not, whatever happens, I'm ready. You see, we live in a state of grace because Jesus died for us. That means right now, if I pass away, I'm going to go to heaven. And that's my joy and my peace. That is what we have because Jesus Christ gave himself for us. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life eternal. Amen. At this time, we continue with the prayers of the church. Please rise. Dear Lord, you are so very good to us. We thank you that you forgive us for the times that we are selfish, that we are not generous, that we keep all that you have given to us to ourselves without sharing with others who are in need. We thank you also, dear Lord, for the times that you discipline us, that you remind us that all we have is from you, and that you show us again that we can trust in you and your provision. We come to you today, dear Lord, and we ask first of all that you would care for those who don't have enough, whether it's enough food, enough money to pay bills, whether they don't have proper clothing, whether it is that they are without friends, that they are without medical care. Whatever it is, dear Lord, provide for them, and please, by your Holy Spirit, inspire us to be your tools to do so. Dear Lord, we ask also that amidst all the challenges that are going on in our country today, that you would fill our hearts with peace. Remind us that your Son, Jesus, still died for us, that he rose again, that he is on the throne. Remind us that we have Thanksgiving, and we have Advent, and we have Christmas, and all the things that are coming up, regardless of the challenges, because you are always here for us. We ask, dear Lord, that you would protect us, especially in the midst of COVID, as we will have get-togethers. We pray that they would be safe and that they would be an opportunity to share love, but not an opportunity for many to grow ill. Most of all, dear Lord, we ask that you would make us ever mindful of what you have given to us. As we come and we bring our meager offerings to you, remind us that you gave us grace and mercy and forgiveness and eternal life with you because you sacrificed so much in your Son, Jesus Christ, that he died and rose again to give us life eternal. In Jesus' name, amen. As we sing our next hymn, a reminder that our plates are there for your offerings, and we are seated for our next hymn. We continue at this time with the Lord's Prayer, found on page 209 in our hymnals. The Lord's Prayer, please rise. We pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We continue turning to page 212 in our hymnals with the Benedicamus and benediction. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be
to God. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Close with our final hymn.
Thank you. States of America.